On Sunday, the 7th of April, 1963, exactly a week before Easter Day, the chief scout, Sir Charles MacLean, paid his first visit to Kibblestone Camp to see something of the scouts and cubs of North Staffordshire. The day was dry and sunny, but a decidedly stiff and cold east wind swept the exposed parts of the site, on which nearly 600 scouts and scouters had spent the previous night in camp. 9:55 a.m. at Wetmore Mill. All was anticipation. He's here! Chief Scout's full title is Major Sir Charles Hector Fitzroy MacLean, 11th Baronet of Duart and Moraven, and 27th Chief of the Clan MacLean, and his home is a castle on a little island called Mull on the west coast of Scotland. We were privileged that in spite of a heavy programme, he found time to visit North Staffordshire. His aim is to visit every branch of his Scout family in all countries of the Commonwealth. Scout's own service was held in a large marquee, which at other times during the weekend gave welcome shelter from the wind, and where great quantities of hot drinks were served by members of the BP Scout Guild. The tour begins, and from now on the chief not only keeps to his schedule, but gets well ahead of it. But first to stop at the pool, reputed to be the coldest in the country, but used throughout the whole year by enthusiasts, Spartans, and madmen. The chief's next stop is the Copeland cabin with its internal improvements, the gift of the ladies' committee of the association. This important day in the camp's history is commemorated by the inscription carved by a scouter on the new oak mantelshelf. Set into a steep slope in the woods is the open-air chapel, with its altar level with the treetops. The simple inscription reads, "Praise to the holiest in the height." From now onwards, starting with Stoke and Burslem divisions in the boys' field, The chief shook hands with every boy and every man in camp and had a bit to say to many of them. Others were asked questions and found themselves nonplussed at the speed with which Sir Charles fired his queries. Matched the invigorating wind as he breezed from troop to troop, talking, quipping, questioning and commenting. The impact of his presence was terrific. I'm saying nothing here. It might be recorded. Seemed deep in conversation. The next, he was gone, leaving the boys wondering what had hit them. That was the chief, that was. Senior Scout's motto greets the chief at the Hanley Division's gateway. How many scouting gateways of welcome and friendship has he passed through during his worldwide travels?
Recently I've been to Kenya, Uganda, Tanganyika. Last year I went to Rhodesia, Nyasaland and New Zealand. I've been to Australia and Hong Kong. And I'm going back to Africa later this year, and at the end of the year I'm going for 2 months to the West Indies.
Division District Commissioner proudly led the chief round his ranks. The DC quite overlooked the needs of the cameraman. Look, old chap, it's me they came to photograph, not you. Treetop's house intrigues the chief, and he goes up the ladder to investigate.
He keeps his money in his sporran. I saw him open it when he bought some chocolate in the camp shop.
Mm-hmm.
Longton in their spinny corner eagerly await the chief. Introductions and still more comments and questions. Obvious approval for scout hats. His most popular possession is often his sheath knife. He is taught never to misuse it. Some seniors who have been on gate duty hurry down for their promised meeting with the chief. Into Larchwood Hollow to see the stone scouts. Kibblestone camp is within the stone boundaries, and the local scouts have the advantage of all its facilities within easy reach.
The chief said we can't leave this unfinished. Well, Peel, sir.
A punning crack brings blood from a stone and a special signature for the logbook. Having tasted blood, he is reminded by the county commissioner that it's nearly time for elevenses. He sets off over the Lyme Bridge, recently completely rebuilt, crosses Jubilee Drive, says cheerio to two young Uttoxeter scouts, and strides along the pathway up to the Rover Den. Coffee for 12, but for Sir Charles, part of his pinter. The fourth chief scout adds his signature to those of his predecessors, BP, Lord Somers and Lord Rowalland. The Rover Den is the hub of Kibblestone Camp, and its weekend occupants have little opportunity to reminisce over the unique collection of souvenirs from all parts of the world. A speedy nibble with an eye on the clock. Others may linger, but for the chief scout, the order of the day is step this way, sir, and step out he does, this time to Cheadle. The chief has some discussion with the seniors about the pros and cons of long trousers. Away now to climb Cuckoo Bank. Cuckoo Bank, with its distinctive trees, is well known to many people who may never have been to Kibblestone, for it has always been used as the camp emblem. On On this exposed site is the Leek and the Moorlands encampment, which takes a full force of the northeast wind. On a day like this, waiting for the chief scout can be a cold business. The berry has largely usurped the traditional scout hat, but needs to be worn correctly. Scout uniforms throughout the world are quite varied. The chief remarked that there is even a troop in Uganda which wears the kilt. Shelter of the Ronald Copeland Training Centre, the Newcastle Division are standing ready to welcome their chief. To the training centre buildings to inspect the group room and dormitory, adapted from the old stables and hayloft, all that remains of Kibblestone Hall, the home of the Copeland family until the 1950s. Exciting assault course makes good use of some of Kibblestone's sturdy cedars and Spanish chestnut trees. Was away in stone as the guest of honour at a luncheon for 200 scout leaders, officials and civic heads. While this was going on, troops and patrols were busy in camp. Cooks in the kitchens were serving up hot meals or picnic-style snacks. A pleasant break before the afternoon rally. A bit of music and sunshine to be enjoyed in spots sheltered from the searching wind. The Leek Scout bands entertain the scouts and visitors as they arrive for the afternoon rally. While the wolf cubs of the county, a thousand or more, line the winding drive of the training centre. At 3 p.m. the chief arrives at the main gate to make his way to the rally arena. He is taken aback by the deafening cheers from the cubs. Wave after wave after wave of it marked his progress along the 250 yards, the grandest howl ever heard at Kibblestone. Again he stopped and talked to scores of cubs and their cub masters. Utter astonishment, surprise or delight is registered in their faces as Sir Charles chats, bending down to catch replies. The cheering does not end until the chief emerges into the rally area to be greeted by the general salute. He then moves through the crowds to the dais, where he is to present a Queen Scout badge to Trevor Maudling and the silver acorn to Mr. Harold Bloor. The Chief Scout, when making the presentation of the Queen's Scout badge, said that the message on the certificate was from Her Majesty the Queen and not from the Boy Scouts Association. He finished his remarks by saying,
"And the Queen also wishes you Godspeed on your journey through life. Remember that no journey is worth making unless you take God with you and ask Him to show you the way. I add my congratulations to those of Her Majesty, and I wish you great happiness and all good fortune in the years to come. Well done."
And now, Sir Charles, would you be good enough to present to Harold a gold Bloor of Leek, the silver acorn?
Bloor. May do it.
Six hours have sped by. The official program is now over. Leaving the dais, the chief makes his way to the training center buildings for another glass of milk and to say a friendly farewell to the county commissioner and other guests. Bentley waits at the end of the drive, and the onlookers catch a skillful demonstration of how to enter a car in a kilt and keep one's dignity. Away he goes, and we echo the sentiments of the old Scottish song, "Will ye no come back again?"